Well, hello everyone. Here we are again, a few months later. It's been quite a winter, and it's not over. But it's been full of stuff, as they say. And now we're trying to work our way back to a really wonderful, healthy, normal life. And the arts are here to help us do that. Our program for tonight is based upon the music of France. Over the years, I've done many programs dealing with one country, and I've had a lot of emphasis at certain moments on France, but this one came together because I had a certain piece that was available to me, and that is how I think. I put things together based upon what's available, how I can weave it together into something that I think makes a good program. So we're having a French program tonight, and one of the things that came to me after I decided it was going to be a French program was that there was a perfect thing for me to put in this. You probably know that my great colleague and our friend Kim Kashkashian has founded something called Music for Food, which is more than ever in this time when hunger is such a terrible issue in society, and particularly now during the pandemic, struggles to do things to bring food to people. A month or so ago, she had an all Ravel program. And the first part of the program was music that she and the pianist Robert Levin, with whom she's played for years, created out of songs of Maurice Ravel. He was very interested in music and sources from all different kinds of cultures. In 1904, this is kind of amazing, he had a wide circle of many different kinds of friends in Paris, where he lived, and there was going to be a lecture recital at the Sorbonne about Greek folk music. So a friend of a friend came to him and said, that friend was Michel Dimitri Calvo Koressi, who was Greek-born, Greek heritage person, and said, we've found some wonderful songs from the island of Chios, which is a Greek island that at that time was Turkish, and it's very near the Turkish border, of wonderful variety of songs, and they're unaccompanied. And we've got a terrific singer who wants to sing them, but she won't sing them unless there are piano accompaniments. So Maurice, can you help us? So he went home, and in 36 hours, he had written piano accompaniments for them. So when you listen to them, it's going to be the mixture of this raw, unadorned Greek folk melody. And by the way, the texts are all online for you to read, and I urge you to do that because they're all very interesting. And Ravel, when you listen to them, you can say, hey, that really sounds like music by Ravel. Well, I mean, it's entitled to, he wrote it. But he wrote it absolutely from himself in reaction to this folk music. A year or so later, he was a little bit unsatisfied about some of them being part of an ongoing published group. And his friend came up with three more folk songs from Chios, spelled C-H-I-O-S. And those are the songs, those three that came in the second batch, coupled with two from the first batch, that now became permanently five Greek songs. And that is what we're going to hear. Now, I should tell you that all of these arrangements have been made jointly by Kim and Robert, and it's easy because the viola is the voice and the piano is Ravel, but they're very, very affecting. A little bit later, to go on in their portion of our program tonight, in 1914, Ravel was asked to take some Jewish melodies, Hebrew melodies, and to make accompaniments for them, to set them. The first one that was set is called Kaddish. And Kaddish, for any Jewish person who is observant, is the name of a very special prayer. And it's a prayer that means sanctification, glory to God. And it's a very beautiful prayer, but it's mostly familiar to Jewish people, at least I am Jewish and I grew up with that, is that it is sung in remembrance or at the time of death of somebody. And so it's a very mournful, very, very, but at the same time exhilarating. Death is part of the scheme of things, and it's glorifying to God for that. It's a very, very beautiful setting. That is followed by the second Hebrew melody called the Eternal Enigma, which is basically, what is life? Nobody knows. Why is life? What is it about? And those are the two Hebrew melodies. And the third of them that they did is called, I always pronounce it wrong, I'll get it, Tripatos, which is kind of the same thing about you just don't understand existence. And it's words about something like the doctor delivers the baby and who knows whether the baby will live or what will become of that person. And you never know, and tra-la-la-la-la-la, that's just the way it is. So this is a really, really beautiful set of songs by Ravel, and that's the first part of our program.
Thank you. Thank you.
So somehow, as a natural segue to Ravel, is something that he was very interested and influenced by. We're talking here about how cultures affect one another and how political life and the history of the world and things that happen that are good and bad have an impact, sometimes unexpected, on one another. It happens that in the early part of the 20th century, when Ravel was active, was a period of great distress for Black Americans. And particularly, we're thinking today about those who were in the world of jazz, who could perform in America, but had great trouble in living. If they went to a new town to sing or to play, they were restricted with what hotels they could stay in. They were separated, the audiences were separated. It was a really tough time. And yet, out of that entire period arose some of the great music of America and of the world. And so we're going to example some of that. We have three selections today, and to weave them into what the players of today, who are not, of course, those famous people who came before, are going to show reverence for and respect for the sources that have influenced where we are today. What I want to talk about tonight, for our program tonight, is about the influence of the jazz, Black jazz musicians who came to and worked in France, and what influence that had. The first person I want to talk about is Josephine Baker. She was probably what really put it into motion that Black jazz musicians came to France. She was born in St. Louis in 1906, and she grew up a really hard-scrabble life in poverty, single parent, trying to earn money, busking on the street, singing, dancing, getting whatever. And it turned out she was pretty talented at that. And also living life really just as it was. She married for the first time at the age of 13. And that didn't last very long. And she married the next time at the age of 15. And that person's name was Willie Baker. And so she became Josephine Baker. And that's the name she kept for her whole life because that's how she began as a professional. Very soon, she found her way to New York City because there was a lot going on there in the Black community, and there's something we call the Harlem Renaissance with Langston Hughes and a lot of great artists of many sorts. She was in revues there where she was in the chorus line, and somehow or other, she was the one that everybody noticed in the chorus line. She had a great personality, and it was very vibrant. And yet it was very hard to work in New York for her. She wasn't getting the success, and life was not easy with the segregation and all of those things. And she had a chance to go to France. So she went there in, let me check my year, 1925. Hey, the Roaring Twenties. There she is. She comes and almost immediately becomes a star. I'm quoting her now. "I became famous first in Paris in the 1920s. And soon she was known as the most successful American jazz artist in France. She was sought out by Ernest Hemingway, who was living there, by Pablo Picasso, and all kinds of important people in the arts. She became automatically better after a series of singing lessons, within suddenly her voice became so well known. And her first dance was called a banana dance. She was wearing this strange costume of artificial bananas, and it was very risque, but everybody was interested in her. And there was no way from there for the rest of her life that she could be ignored. Interestingly, in the Second World War, she was part of the French Resistance. And that's whom we want to honor first. And the song we're taking is called J'ai deux amours, I have two loves. And what were they? Well, they were France and Paris. And she would come from America. So actually the song begins with a stanza that says, I know in New York there's a fancy city with all kinds of tall buildings, but I have two loves, and those are those. Now, we have somebody wonderful from our community who is going to sing her. It's a young man named Matthew Schifrin. Matthew's been a student here for 4 years in the CI department, Contemporary Improvisation Department, and he was born blind. And he's going to sing this song. He has a high tenor voice in which he uses for this kind of music. And he plays the accordion, and he's going to accompany himself. And the one thing I want to give you a plug for him, because he's a very remarkable person. He's created a blog which is called Blind Guy Travels. So please look it up and follow him. He's even been hired by the Lego company to create Lego instructions for blind people. The last person I want to talk about today is not from America at all. He was born in Belgium, and we know him as Django Reinhardt. Django probably was a nickname for Jean Reinhardt as he was born, and he was a guitar player. He started off with something early. He played violin because there was music in his family, but he eventually somebody gave him something called a banjo guitar, and he started playing it. And he was amazing. And he was just, many people say, the greatest instrumentalist in the jazz tradition in France, historically. Now, we don't have him here to play, but we're going to try and do an homage to him. A few things to tell you about him. One thing is very remarkable. He was what in France was known as Romani, which we would call gypsy. There was a very large Romani community in France. And it is true that they were prejudiced against, and it got worse later. So in a way, they were experiencing what black people were experiencing in America. And so he was part of a Romani caravan where he lived in a wagon. And his wife, who was doing things with acetate in their cabin, the stuff, the acetate was all over the place, and he tipped over a candle by accident, and it caused a huge fire. The whole wagon burst into flames. He survived, but not easily. It took him 18 months to recover. He was told at one point he might lose a leg, but he said, no, I'm not going to give it up, and he did. But what he did lose was the use of these two fingers. Now, can you imagine? I'm a cellist, you know. How could I play without all those fingers? He retaught himself how to play so that he played everything with that, the thumb and two fingers. And these fingers occasionally he would use, he could put sideways to rest on them to make like a barred chord or something like that. And he was so inventive. And he was not playing jazz yet until in the 1930s. He got together with somebody who was equally famous, a French violinist named Stéphane Grappelli. And they created the quintet of the Hot Club of France. And they were all strings. And they became the most popular ensemble, jazz ensemble in France. But he became world famous. He came to the United States. He played in London with a group, and the great American movie star Eddie Cantor was in the audience, stood up, walked up on the stage, and hugged him. I mean, it was just, he was such a presence, such an important thing, important person. Now, the last thing and the historical thing is that with the 1930s, by the time he was doing it, was the rise of Nazism in Germany. And when the Nazis overran France in the early 1942, I guess it was, that they were discriminating. First of all, they thought that jazz was decadent music. And in Germany, you could not have jazz. And the Romani were treated as bad as the Jews. And in France, however, there was still so much love for jazz and for Romani music that somehow it was tolerated. We have two songs that we're referencing in this program. One is called Claire de Lune. Now, that's not the Debussy piece. That's a different piece, Moonlight. And Les Yeux Noirs, Black Eyes, which is, of course, more like Russian folk music and Russian popular music. When you hear that played, you will know exactly what you're listening to. And I guess that rounds out what we're going to do for jazz in this program.
Thank you.
The last piece on our program tonight is by a composer everybody knows about, and this piece everybody knows. It's the string quartet by Claude Debussy. Debussy wrote it, and I have almost nothing to tell you about it because everybody knows about it. I'll just say that Debussy wrote it in the early 1890s, 1892, I think it was written, and it's become one of the cornerstones of the string quartet repertory. Interestingly, along with the quartet written later by Maurice Ravel. Those two are the two great French string quartets of that time. Just to put it in perspective for you a little bit, the moment when Debussy becomes kind of everybody, what is this man doing, is 2 years later when he writes a piece called Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun. And from that moment on, everybody knows that Debussy is creating a world of music that never existed before. He is doing things with Pelléas and Mélisande and all kinds of music that are just so groundbreaking in terms of how he uses the orchestra. Yes, maybe he was a little bit influenced by Rimsky-Korsakov because he lived in Russia for a couple of years. By the way, he was the secretary to Nadezhda von Meck, who was the secret supporter, the distant supporter of Tchaikovsky. So he was there in Russia for a couple of years, and that may have had something to do with how he approached orchestration. But enough said. This is a great piece. This has been a fun program to put together, and I hope you really enjoy the whole evening and have enjoyed it up to this point, and see you again soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.